And we're back in Cliaban Rilag level 2. Finally got through this door that's really tough with mechanics, but we ended up getting plus 3 mechanics. Because after we couldn't get through here, we went up a level. So I gave Durance a level in mechanics, and now he's wearing a glove that gives you plus 2 mechanics. So, pretty freaking awesome. We can finally get past here. We've explored the rest of level 2. As far as I can tell, it's just this door.
No problem.
Ain't got a problem. Ain't got a problem. Oh, we go up. Okay. No, there was this area over a bridge or something like that that we couldn't get to. That's probably where that's going. I would think. Hmm. Nothing searchable that we can look at so far. Ooh, I heard something weird. Sound like someone dragging something. Ooh. That sounds spooky. Which way should we go? This way? What happens if we go on this thing? Nothing? We can't look at anything. Oh, there's somebody there. Just look this way. What's this? You hear running water. No kidding. And see a small stream that carves its way into the mountain. Inspect the stream. A shallow bottom flickers and wavers just under the water's edge. But as you look toward the tunnel, the bottom disappears into darkness. From here, it is impossible to tell how deep the stream is. However, a faint light plays along the walls of the tunnel. The echo of rushing water suggests that the tunnel and stream continue for quite some distance. Well, we're not leaving. Although, clicking leave is kind of misleading. Well, we know how we're going to leave here. We stop sneaking. Came from that way. Oh, we're playing out something, okay. There's another machine. What? Why are we... I hate when it does that. Oh! And who is that? Aloth? Aloth, what the hell are you doing? You're destroying the Ash People. A haze of essence lingers over the body, as faint and insubstantial as a dust plume in a rider's wake. Yet, as you draw closer, whispered instructions echo in your ears, and anticipation warms your blood. In a vision, you see the same stone machine you approached moments ago, but from a different height and angle, as if through different eyes. You'd heard rumors that some of your brethren were sent here months before, yet you see no sign that anyone has been here. In fact, the cobblestones are covered in a fine layer of dust. Ash. You know suddenly what this will cost you, and you are ready. What is it going to cost me? My sanity? The orders were clear. The effects of the machine in Cliaban Rilag were wearing off. A child had been born not far from Deerford recently, its soul intact. The machine would need to be reactivated. No, it doesn't. You and your companions take up your positions. You share a final look of affirmation between yourselves. They don't know your name, and you don't know theirs, but you know that you're doing the work of the gods together. None of the rest matters. So the gods are obviously angry that someone used that god hammer bomb. And they don't want us to have souls anymore. Or at least the new members of society, so to speak. Two carved bands of stone in the middle of the machine grind into motion. They rotate in opposite directions, picking up speed until they spin like freshly greased carriage wheels. A wind shrieks through the cavern, accelerating with the stone rings. You press your hands to your ears and grit your teeth against the noise. You're about to shut your eyes when you glimpse new movement. Rows of triangular flaps around the machine open like petals. You don't know what's happening in the machine, but you feel a tingling at your extremities. Searing pain spreads through your body, a hot knife separating every tissue and ligament within you. All the while, it feels as if you're falling toward the machine, your stomach mashed against your spine. What happens next is too fast to process. You awaken from the vision to find yourself kneeling and gasping for air. Holding your head, you let the tiles between your knees gradually come into focus. As you catch your breath, you remember the strange scene you saw outside Salant Lee, where several robed figures fell amidst a howling Biowek. Yes, beginning of the game. Or near the beginning. Looking at the ash scattered across the cavern floor, it is apparent that the leaden key has been doing this. Whatever it is, all over the Deerwood. I saw a vision of the leaden key agents surrendering their souls to the Ingwithin machine in Cliaban Rilag. They perform the same ritual I received outside Silant Lee, which means they must be doing this all over the Deerwood. The thoughts of one of the agents suggested that they were there to ensure that infants in the area would be hollowborn. Bad people! Shame on yourselves. Something in the ether hums and buzzes through your teeth. Minor adventure. Oh, I thought that was reacting to me. Well, the only reason I'm gonna sneak, really.
Nice and quiet.
Is to look for secrets. But I don't know if there's anything else to see here. I can approach this thing, but I don't know if anything would happen. Apparently not. Alright. We're gonna take a flume ride. We gotta return to Madame Webb, Lady Webb, something. You take slow, sloshing steps towards the mouth of the tunnel, holding yourself upright while the current tugs at your legs. The cold water leaves you gasping, and as it rises past your waist, you fight to control your breaths. The stream bed soon drops out from under your feet, and the current pushes you towards the tunnel with growing force. Swim into the tunnel. The current pushes you through the tunnel faster and faster, tugging you downward. Over your head, the tunnel narrows and drops, leaving only a thin pocket of air. You take a final deep breath before the current drags you into the depths. Rays of light pierce the darkness. Loving the sound effects, but the current is moving too fast now for you to see more than flickering glimpses as you speed by. You keep your hands in front of yourself and focus on avoiding the jagged rocks that appear suddenly in the darkness jutting from the walls. A light winks at you up ahead. You're approaching it fast, but it looks to be the mouth of a second, smaller tunnel. You might be able to reach it, but your lungs have started to ache. Grab the edge of the tunnel. I don't know what the difference is, but... You wrap your fingers around the rocks lining the tunnel and peer into it. It terminates in a dead end, but something glints among the rocks at the far side. Reaching it would be a challenge for anyone without strong lung capacity. Send Adair. Big strong guy. Adair pulls himself into the tunnel, executing deft scissor kicks while the passage narrows. At the end, he finds a skeleton with a handle protruding from its ribs. Adair pulls it free and pushes off from the wall, propelling himself back toward the main tunnel. Swirling and tumbling through the darkness of the tunnel, you at last see a halo of light above, and you swim and kick toward it. At last, your head breaks the surface. You gulp air into your aching lungs, and you pull yourself to the edge of the pool. Crawling out of the water, you look at the cavern around you as you massage feeling back into your aching, cold, numb limbs. We've gained the Rose of Salt Hollow. Oh. This is where I was wondering if I could go there. Alright. Wrong thing. The Rose of Salt Hollow. It's a unique morning star. 18 to 26 crush. Plus 25% corrode damage. 20% of damage restored is endurance. Nice. Plus 4 accuracy, plus 15% damage. A young weapon with a relatively short history, the rose was forged from blackened Emirin steel and topped with a wickedly thorny bloom of petals. The morning star is a resemblance to its namesake. The morning star's resemblance to its namesake doesn't end with its head, okay. Its long faded black shaft also features small thorns along the entire length, causing discomfort even to an armored wearer. Huh. Doesn't seem to cause us damage. Hakran Grist, a successful adventurer from the Red Saren seaside village of Salt Hollow, had the gnarly weapon made after his friends joked about how nothing could grow in the alkaline soil of their home. Hakran used the rose to defend Salt Hollow from bandits and to help his comrades kill two sky drakes who had made their lair near a road leading into the village. When Salt Hollow no longer held the wonder for them that it once had, Hakran and his friends made their way to Deerwood to seek their fortunes in the ruins of Ir Glanfath. They have not been heard from since. This is uncomfortable to wear, causes discomfort. But I don't see where it's hurting us at all. Oh. Oh, hold on.
Eh?
Following your lead.
Eh?
Eh. That's a flail. That's a morning star. I'm not going to keep this. Why are there people with slow weapons? And for a cipher, fast weapons are the best. Because the more times you hit your enemy, the more focus you get back, so you can cast more spells. So I'm just going to put this in the stash. Well, we got to head back. Everybody, come on. Let's go. Get the hell out of here. Well, that was interesting. We came back to this dungeon, didn't fight a single enemy. Pretty cool. Okay, now back to... guess we'll go to First Fires. Return that item to... what's her name? And then we have to head to Brackenbury. I'm pretty sure she's in Ducal Palace. So at Brackenbury, yeah, we have to return to the Lady Webb. It's a major quest. Yeah, she's in there. Oh, I meant to hit that. Da-ling! Does Sidley have anything new to say? Nope. Hail! Fyrga.
Good day, stranger.
She nods. May you be guided and tempered by the flame. Present the burning stone. I journeyed to Searing Falls myself. This is what I found there. She takes the stone in her hands and gasps. By the flame! Do you know what this is? Should we tell her? Why the hell not? It's a fragment of the Godhammer bomb. Yes! She turns it in her hands. The very weapon that Magrin herself helped us build to defeat Widewind in the Saint's War. She turns the stone in her hands, gazing into its bright glow. Adair says, it's weird seeing it right in front of you like that. Before it was just stories. Never seemed real. Fyrga's mouth twists into a frown, and the orange light carves deep shadows across her face. So why don't I feel any differently? What good does this do? Her knuckles whiten as she tightens her fingers around the stone. Number two is pretty brutal. For some reason, I envision Canna saying number one. You hold part of a weapon designed by a god. The very existence of such a thing should fill you with awe. Her face relaxes, and her eyes drink in the glowing thing in her hands. So it does. It's not an answer, but it has meaning. She closes her hands around the stone and tucks it away. I'd forgotten how important that is. And we got a chunk of experience. Durin says, meaning. She has no idea what it means, what it represents, what went into it. Fyrga looks at the statue, and a flame springs from its raised hands. One of the things I have always loved about Magrin is her affinity for fire, how it grows and spreads. You feel the warmth from the fire rippling across the room. You've given me what I need. I'll make sure to give the people of Defiance Bay the support they need. Now, let me give you something you might need. She disappears, returning quickly with something in her hands. A weapon worthy of the goddess herself. Please accept it as thanks for your service to Magrin and to me. Thank you. Farewell. Gain something. So I reminded Fyrga that the Godhammer fragment itself was proof of Magrin's power and wonder. Fyrga took heart from this and was able to rekindle the sacred fires. Well, the minor adventure is completed already.
Hello.
Goodbye. Okay, I guess we're done in here. That was quick. When do we get to peek into the special conference going on? Which has been going on for, like, apparently months? Off to Brackenbury with us. Take a peek at our quest log. Inform Lady Webb. Twin Elms will be heading there soon. The rest of these are companion stuff and paths of Ardnua. She wants to kill me. Not getting a child knife. Ardnua. So yeah, we're getting rid of some quests. Getting rid of a lot of quests here. Alright, so she's over here at Hadred House.
Welcome.
Huh. Courier says, excuse me, but I've been looking for you. You're the one who lifted the curse on Heritage Hill. My lady, who wishes to remain anonymous, has entrusted me with bringing you this pistol. It belonged to a dear friend of hers who was lost to the curse. Oh. Might be that lady in Crucible Keep. For your part in reclaiming Heritage Hill, my lady wishes you to have it. Here, may it serve you well in battle. Thank you. You are quite welcome, St. Garam's Spark. Now I must be off. Farewell. Oh boy. He's definitely off. Oh, what am I doing? A pistol. Very slow. 25 to 35 pierce versus deflection. Plus 10 accuracy granted to the ally attacking the same target. She gets this too. Plus 25% shock damage. 6 damage reduction bypass. 0.3 to crit damage multiplier. St. Garam was a priest of Hylea, known for his mastery of the art of wordplay. It was said that he could shape the mood of a crowd with a single word and find with cruel precision the most shocking turn of phrase with which to dismantle an opponent. One more whimsical daughter of the Deerwood had this pistol crafted in his honor, for the gun, too, she said, could put an end to any debate. Well, who's got a pistol? He does. He's got an arquebus. I don't know what we're doing.
Yes?
I'm ready.
Yeah. You're ready to compare your weapons. Damage isn't as good. Same crit damage multiplier, same damage reduction bypass. You know what? We're gonna sell this freaking thing. Sad to say, it's not that great of a weapon. Oh, we didn't check this Unforgiven, or did we? Yeah, this Unforgiven thing. I dub it Unforgiven. Damage, 13 to 19 crush versus deflection. Plus 30% of grazes converted to hits. Exceptional. Plus 8 accuracy, plus 30% damage. 20% attack speed. 25% burn damage. Pretty good. The origin of this item is a point of contention among the followers of Aethas and Wodica. Aethasians claim that their priest had it commissioned in the early aftermath of the Saints' War in hopes that it would coax their god back into the world to finish what he started. Wodicans, on the other hand, claim that the item is older than that, an instrument of retribution against oathbreakers originally employed by the Steel Garot, an order of Wodican paladins devoted to the enforcement of oaths and contracts, often in mirthless fashion. The flail itself is unique in that the spiked ball at its end was fashioned out of an incense burner, and when it sees a vigorous use, the smell of incense blankets the area. Its reputation has led to a handful of notable deceptions whereby people who defy their ingredients were frightened into honoring them when the smell of incense was introduced into their negotiation room or bedchamber. Well, let's compare it with what we have, then. Which is Gone Share. I'm not sure. We picked up a bunch of things recently. I'm not sure where we got this one from. Same crush versus deflection. Just as fast. Same grazes. We get corrode damage. Here we got burn damage. This has 20% attack speed, though. And it's exceptional. Yeah, we're gonna use the Unforgiven. Gone Share has served us well. I thank you for your service. Nice. Swing that thing around. Alright, let's go. Talk to the Lady Webb. What a fine web she weaves at that.
No problem.
Where is she again? In here? Aye.
How fares your search?
I have other questions. I'm gonna get to that, but...
Yes?
No. There is something I can tell you about the Leaden Keys operations.
Well, let's hear it.
Oh! We haven't told her this yet. I guess we can tell her both, right? The Anguithan Tower in Heritage Hill contains an ancient machine that can control the flow of souls. The Leaden Key activated it.
This is troubling. That civilization seems to have known more about the mechanics of souls than anyone since. The Leaden Key was born in that period. It may be that Theos has full knowledge of their technology. The applications of this machine you speak of. I don't want to think about it. That isn't enough to take to the Duke, but we're close. Avar Wolfgrim is a cautious man. He will want to know everything possible before being moved to action.
But wait! That is not all. The Leaden Key is manipulating a group of Anguithan machines that span the country, and it seems to be causing the Hollowborn epidemic.
I had feared they might be involved in Widewind's legacy. It seemed Too extreme, even for them. How naive I've been. The Leaden Keys conspiracy is clear now. They have used Anguithan technology to engineer Wildwind's legacy, and they want people to blame Animancy for it. As we speak, the Duke is holding hearings in the palace. He is listening to arguments for and against Animancy. When they finish, he is expected to decide whether to outlaw it. It seems the Leaden Key has been pushing Deerwood down this path for some time. I, for one, would enjoy seeing their little scheme fouled up at the last moment. Our Duke must hear what you have to say. Unfortunately, the hearings are closed to the public, which makes the Duke inaccessible until they are completed. However, certain groups have been invited to attend. You might get in with one of them if you aren't above a little pandering. There are delegations from the Knights of the Crucible, the Dozens, and from House Dominel. If you can gain the support of one of those groups, that may be your best way in. See what you can arrange.
Huh. Ironically, definitely not House Dominel. I would say we probably have the best standing with Knights of the Crucible, even though I do not like them. I want to discuss the Animancy hearings at the palace.
What of them?
Wouldn't they allow a guest of Dunreed Row into the hearings?
We would only do that as a last resort. Walking in with one of the three invited groups puts you in a position of influence. Walking in alone as a representative of Dunreed Row would earn you distrust among all the rest. It seems our organization has a reputation for nosiness and manipulation, for whatever reason.
She glances to one side.
It would be best if people did not see Dunreed Row's hand in this. Easier for them to embrace the truth.
What is there to know about the Duke?
Avar is many things to many people, and that is why he sits the throne. To the frontiersmen, he is one of their own. To the patriotic, he is a sole descendant of Admeth Hadrit. To the nobility, he is from an old and established family. All of these are half-truths or exaggerations, a tale he has spun around himself. The man behind the tale may not be the greatest mind in Deerwood, but he knows people. He knows when they are sincere and when they lie. He knows when they are strong and when they are weak. The other matters he leaves to me. Outwardly, he prefers to come off a bit of a simpleton. Don't be fooled. Before he was a duke, he was a trapper, and an excellent one at that.
So I check to see if there's anything else you can talk to her about.
What of them? Yes?
No, farewell. Get invited to join one of the Animancy hearing delegations. Oh, I know where these people are. Knights of the Crucible, champion, overwhelmingly good. The Dozens, eccentric, faintly mixed. House Dominel, troubler, troublemaker, faintly bad. We're going to Crucible Keep, everybody. I've done a few quests for them, I just don't like them much personally. Oh. So this will be exciting. We'll get to stand in on the conference. I was just saying, too, how I Wanted to hear what they were talking about. They've got to be bringing in plenty of food and drink, taking bathroom breaks. I mean, they've been there forever. Alright, so stay tuned. The next episode, it actually works out to our advantage. We only have to go to First Fires, visit the Knights of the Crucible, and from there, probably straight on to the other building in First Fires, the Embassy? Not the Embassy. Whatever that is, the palace we were just at. So thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.